Thank you very much, and thank you very much for each of you for coming today. We really appreciate that. I would like also to thank Sir Vanessa and Sir Goyo, my colleagues here. Our topic today is, the umbrella of our topic is scenario-based learning, but under this umbrella, there are many things. There are formative assessment, task-based learning, project-based learning, and content-based learning, and we will, in a few minutes, we will show how all this are connected together. First of all, let's start with the scenario-based learning, and before I start, I have an issue I would like to discuss with you, and this came up actually a few months ago when we had a team building. Usually, in any team building, we focus on team building activities, but our colleagues, they brought some issues on the table. These issues were, their students were in beginning of semester two, and they noticed that in the early program scenario, when it comes to semester two, students start to panic a little bit, because they start to have more, a huge amount of vocabulary, grammar, cultural references, and students were putting a lot of effort to catch up, and there are, at this stage of the course, there are a lot of tests coming up. Students are sometimes at the beginning of semester two, they are less motivated than the beginning, and they, when we always talk about autonomous learning and motivating students and making our classroom interactive and increase the students' proficiency. But how can we do this when in the middle of course and everyone is down and tired in the middle of the course? So we discussed, we had a lot of discussion, and we came up with something very effective, which is scenario-based learning. It's through scenario-based learning when you bring issues to the classroom to discuss. We always start our classroom with an issue. We put a problem on the table. So for example, if our lesson is about education, when we come to the class, we start saying to our students, listen, we have a problem in Egypt or in that country or in the Middle East in education. We need to find a solution together to increase the students' learning, and we need recommendations from you. So by starting with an issue, which is scenario, this is a scenario. Scenario-based learning. In scenario-based learning, you make your classroom interactive. Because without interaction, you cannot increase the student's proficiency, because we believe that speaking is one of the most important tools to learn a foreign language. You can listen as much as you can, and you can read all the day long, but without interaction, without speaking, you cannot do anything. When you do the listening and learning, reading, and teach grammar, you're teaching students about the language. But if you want to teach the students, if you want to teach the language to the students, it's through interaction and through scenarios. So scenario-based learning makes the classroom interactive. And we talked about the problem-based learning, when you bring a problem and ask everyone else to come together and find a solution for this problem. This way, you increase the students, not only interaction or learning or readiness to learn, but also you increase the level of ability of the students to absorb the language, because they want to come up with solutions. You increase the critical thinking this way. It's through project-based learning and scenario-based learning you make your students more autonomous. Because you want to go to the internet and search for data that you assign to them, and they come up with this data and they present it to you through speaking or writing. And in this way, you expose your students to the media. And when you expose them to the internet, to learning directly from the internet, that's content-based learning. We are hitting many birds with only one stone. Slide, please. Scenario-based learning is based on the principle of situated learning theory. You put students, your students in a situation. For example, if you, I give an example about education. Another example, we have seats here, please, if you would like to come. Let's say you are teaching about a lesson about Arabic-Israeli conflict. And instead of introducing this through listening and reading, discrete listening and reading passages, you can connect all this with creating a scenario that the students work on, and at the end they need to provide their presentation or any type of product. So you can tell them, this is a very long issue in the Middle East, the Arab-Israeli conflict, and you introduce this in the beginning of class, and you say, in this class, we want to come up together with recommendations, effective recommendations that we can send there and help people to solve this problem. So that's the problem-based learning, which puts people in a situation, a situated learning. And in this way, you connect between what we do in the classroom and with real life. Slide, please. We need to simulate the real world practice, because our students, when they are learning our foreign language and they really want to go there one day after, yes, they go to the field and they do their job, but they become intrinsically motivated here to, I'm sure that many of our students think of going to the Middle East, they say, now I know how to use the language, I know how to speak, I know how to solve problems, I can talk about many things. I can order food, I can, and they get intrinsically motivated really to go there in the future, because nobody will take the language from them after they leave. And do you want to practice this in real life? Once we put the students in real life situations here, we prepare them to perform the same thing after they graduate and in the future, because we want to help them to become lifelong learners. Slide, please. We already talked about decision making, because when they give recommendations and give solutions to the problem that you bring on the table, that's decision making. They decide, and this is high cognition, they decide on what to do to solve the problem. So the question now is, I'm not gonna talk about project-based learning a lot or formative assessment, because my colleagues will cover this part, so this is only introduction. How, if it's important to implement the student scenario-based learning and project-based learning, how can you do this? There are five steps we have here. The first step that we can, and you need to identify a learning outcome. You think, do you know about the backward design? When you think of the final product at the end first before you start, and this, a final product moves you. You start from the final product. You want your students to speak to whatever the lesson is about. If it's about ordering food in a restaurant, you want them to be able to do that. Or if there is an issue, societal issue that you need them to find solution for or discuss or be able to talk about, you think about this final product. And by thinking about this final product, this will move everything. Then, and not only thinking about it, but introduce it when you go to class, so students are mentally ready for that. Even when you activate the schemata or do any step of listening or reading or role play or anything, they have in their mind that they are preparing for the final product. So for example, they say, okay, this good works will help me when I give the recommendations at the end, because you already told them what they need to do at the end of class. But for you, when you create a scenario, you need to think also of that final product. The step two is that you decide on the format. And deciding, what we mean by deciding on the format, what format we do? We are doing here face-to-face. We are not doing online learning or blended learning. Excuse me, I just want to get some acid water. We are not doing online learning. We are always the only thing we are doing face-to-face. But what we mean by format here, are you familiar with flipped classroom?
Yes.
So flipped classroom is something similar to blended classroom, because you give the students things to work on at home, listening and reading classes that they need to understand and internalize on their own pace, because they have more time, especially in semester 2 and 3. Because in semester 2 and 3, the passages are articles that are too long, the lectures are longer, and we, many times we had this issue, when we were teaching, we want to cover a lot of things. We want to do a full lesson plan, but teachers, they struggle because the passages, the article, level 2, higher level article, or higher level volume needs a lot of time to process. So we run out of time in the class, and we don't have time to do the other activities that we already put in the lesson plan. Because when we put the lesson plan, we don't know how the students will process that. So we always run out of time. So flipped classroom will help us, will allow students to put as much time as they can, whatever they can at home, and they come to class. And this way we save most of the class time to scenarios, interaction, speaking, because we ignore the speaking, as I said in the beginning, although we think that this is one of the most tools to learn a foreign language. So we have to decide on the format. What kind of format we are doing? Are we doing flipped classroom? Are we doing how we are doing our lesson? So all this, so the first one was the deciding on the final product, how they will present, or how they produce language. The second one is to think about the format. Step three is choose a topic. And we always choose, we don't choose our own topic unless we are in semester 3 and it's open. We usually choose a topic that goes with a textbook, and we need to cover all the flow topics that we have. Some people say, okay, in this case, if we implement the scenario-based learning, let's forget completely about the textbook and do just scenario-based learning and project-based learning. We cannot do this because we have, the textbook is our roadmap. We need to cover everything that we cannot ignore one topic and at least focus on another topic. Step four, identify the trigger event or situation. So as I did in the beginning, I started my presentation with bringing an issue on the table that people had before, and we needed to find a solution for. Always when we go to class, we always do this. Whether I don't care what the topic is, even if it's about situation. A situation like tourism in the Middle East. We come before we start and say we have a problem in the tourism in the Middle East. We need to do things to activate and increase tourism in Egypt or whatever the country, Iraq or any country, because we teach Arabic language from the target culture. So this is what we do. Anything we can turn that into an issue that we can share the students and say, what do you think? We need your help. Students, we need your help. This way the students start to interact, and by trying to help you solve the problem, they think, and guess what? People learn a lot when they are thinking, and they learn the least when they just have the speech passage, they read it or listen to an audio and answer the question and then move to the next one without making that connection between what we're learning and another connection with the real life. And scenario-based makes all this The next step is peer review your scenario, and we need really to work together. If I create a scenario for a lesson, and I have the material, and I have the roadmap and everything, the students, what the students are doing, and if that scenario is good, please share it with your colleagues. You will get feedback from them, and you will give them feedback, because we sometimes reinvent the wheel. We have many ideas, and we create material and scenarios in one team, and other people want to do the same thing. They reinvented the wheel, they do the same thing, and everyone, a lot of wasted effort. But when we share what we have, not only on the team level, unfortunately, we have people in the same team that they teach with separation from each other. We need to get together. We need to really, if we want to succeed, we need to get together, not only by reviewing, peer reviewing our material, but with also peer observation. Why don't we observe each other? We hear about people here observe their colleague 20 years ago when they did the ICC, but now, why don't we have a project that we get together, observe each other, peer observation, co-teaching, and we work close. If we don't work so far, I don't see it happening that we work with. Everyone is working on their own, creating their own material, giving the material to the students, as if we are not one team. I don't want to talk about project-based or other content-based, because our colleagues will do this. I'll come back at the end to answer questions if you have questions. Thank you very much. Yusuf Nasser will lead us in that discussion about that.
Hello for everyone. Thank you again for coming. And I will continue our presentation. We're going to talk here about the project-based learning, but I would like to start with the scenario-based learning that Dr. Dubawi talked a little bit about it. It is not standing alone. We cannot teach or create any scenario-based learning alone. When you create scenario-based, you need a problem. As he said, we need a problem to trigger the situation and let the students think about it. And that's what I'm going to focus on, the problem-based learning, or PBL. Any scenario-based, any PBL, you need content. Without content, how we can create a lesson? That's why I'm going to talk a little bit about CBI, or content-based learning, or sometimes you call it content-based instruction. So many definitions so far for PBL, but I just picked the simplest one. And before we look at the definition here, we need just to think about the traditional teaching hour. When we talk about the traditional teaching hour, we have three words here to talk about the traditional class. The number one here, it's a short. When we teach 1 hour about any topic, it's 1 hour, and the next hour may be a different topic. So there is no link between the first hour and second hour. It's a very short, very limited. The vocabulary not recycled, and the student can learn vocabulary more when the vocabulary keep recycling themselves. When they see the word more than once, already his brain pick it up. And instead of just keep making a vocabulary list, put it in an app, put it in a flashcard, and keep doing this discrete vocabulary, of course he is going to forget this. But when we see the words and the different derivatives, forms of the word in a different context related to the a big or a large topic, automatically his brain will pick up all this vocabulary without it paying attention. I heard this from many students. When they see the word, they keep repeating, they already absorbed it. So the traditional teaching hour, so far at DLI, we don't do this anymore. We are shifting to the modern pedagogical methodology. The second one here for the traditional class isolated. There is no link between what we teach here and teach next hour. Maybe different topics. And also before, the teacher center of the class. The teacher stand in front of the class and they keep lecturing the class, and just the students keep listening and absorbing, and which makes them bored and they feel boring and they cannot cooperate and they be dismotivated by time when the teacher keep lecturing them and he's acting. But for the new methodology, new way, we come across with the BBL, which is gonna be instead of short, it's a long term. You assign a project for students, they're gonna work on it. It could be 5 days, it could be a few weeks, it could be a month, based on what kind of project they're gonna work on it. So it is not short, it's a long term. They're gonna work on it. It is not isolated, it's interdisciplinary. It's cover all aspects of the project. All aspects of the project covered, and they see the whole picture, not only one side of the picture. And at the end, the teacher no more is the center of the class. I'm not gonna do the whole work. I'm gonna assist a little bit, I'm gonna help a little bit, and the students are gonna do the work. So what we call it here, the teacher is a facilitator. This is a brief definition about the BBL, and I found a good video actually to pinpoint on the main elements of the BBL. Let us watch a little bit from this one to see what is the main elements when they apply it in the school.
In project-based learning, students learn through the project.
Oh, interesting.
They address a real-world problem, a driving question, one that can't be Googled and has no single right answer.
We were talking about how can we prepare for Atlanta's change in weather.
Students have voice and choice in PBL, some input into how they'll answer the driving question.
Does anybody think they might have some ideas?
So they gain ownership of their learning.
So those questions led to our investigation.
They collaborate in a process of sustained inquiry, lasting more than a few days.
We've got a whole lot of work to do.
They reflect on their learning through discussions, formative assessments, and critiques of their peers' work.
We are going to take a look at one of your friends' work today.
And then revise their work based on those reflections.
Okay, we got it.
The final product is shared with an audience.
So I think we pay attention to the main elements that the BBL include or have it from the process and at the end of the project. And we can come across these elements that give the students the ownership of the project, that tackles the real world problem, that give students a chance to investigate, to research, to work together, and the teacher just a facilitator to assist them. And that's really their motivation. What is project-based? This is color, you put 10 points to give us more, a wider scope about what is PBL. I'm gonna just move quickly over there. So any PBL, you need to have the process, and you need to, at the end, you need to have a product. If I don't have a product at the end, what is the benefit? The PBL giving students the ownership because they do the investigation by themselves, they do the peer review, they prepare the presentation, they do all the process, so they feel the ownership of the PBL. Also, as we talked a little bit, the any project, it needs a long time. It's not 1 hour or 2 hours or 1 day. It depends what project you assign to your students. The very important thing during the project, students use integrative skills. They use reading, listening, they use speaking, they use even writing when they prepare their presentation. The PBL develops students' understanding through the topic. So that's some point that scholar pointed about the PBL. The PBL increase the collaborating or collaboration between the students. They must cooperate with each other, do group work, do journals, exchange ideas. That increase the collaboration. BBL holding students responsible because we, the facilitator, whatever, he distributes the tasks, and each student has a certain task or two, whatever, and he has to do his job, and he has to do his work, and to prepare something to share it with his own group. So BPL holding students responsible for their work. Also, the BPL assigning the role of the students and the teacher. Each one has a role. He has to do it. At the end, there is a reflection on the post process and the project. Reflection, it is very important. Actually, it is not at the end, but reflection will go through all the project, every single step. Students, even the teachers, you need to think and reflect what we have done, something we need to take care about it, something we need to correct it. Reflection is a critical part when not only for PBL, but for everything in our work here, we need to reflect. Can we see another example for PBL? We're gonna skip some because we leave time for our colleague.
Let's take a look at this project-based world. Meet Claire. She was recently presented with a challenge. Her company, Supersuds, makes soap. And it was up to her to find the most earth-friendly way to produce it in the future. Her boss gave her a budget and a few requirements, and it was up to her to come up with a solution. She organized and managed a team who researched the options and created materials summarizing the issues. Claire's team asked for feedback and presented their findings to the boss. Claire came out of the project looking like a rock star, and she learned a lot about green products. If you look closely, Claire's success involved critical thinking, collaboration, and communication, things that aren't often taught in traditional classrooms. The world needs more Claires, so how do we get them? The answer is project-based learning, or PBL. By focusing students on a project, teachers put them on a path that deepens their knowledge and builds skills they'll need in the future.
Okay, so we talked a little bit about this, let's move quickly. During the BPL, what is the role of the teacher? Provide opportunities for in-depth investigation. Help the students to investigate the issue. Allow learners to become more autonomous. Dr. Bibao referred to this. Because you work on their own. You just assist them. So they feel they own it. And this is develop the autonomous. They become more autonomy learner. Motivate the student because they feel they do the work. That's great. We're going to skip this. This is a science teacher. He gives the students exam on Friday, and all the students, I summarize it because there's some time, all the students scored A. But after the weekend, they start to ask them about the knowledge, and they forgot everything. And it's a serious problem. Why does he forget? And he start to think. He come across PBL, and they start to put, he noticed that it was the season of flu, and a couple of the students were absent from the class, and he started to raise this issue with his students. What is the problem? Why many students just got flu and they absent? And they start to drive question, they investigate the issue, and they come to the solution. And when they investigate this, we have an MCA Unit 8, talk and deal with the health issue. This is a perfect example, and they find a solution for it. So we need to, if we have time, we can show this because another video. Project-based learning increase longer term, as we said. Better engage student and teacher, improve skills, to solve the problems, collaboration, time management, understanding of real world applications. As Dr. Bibao referred to two other problems in the Middle East, improved responsibility because the student's responsible to his part, and improve understanding. We can watch just a few seconds of this.
Project-based learning, capture your student's attention with real world problems. Project-based learning is often abbreviated to the acronym PBL, which will be used throughout the video. So, why should educators use PBL in their classroom? Projects are often assessed through presentations Having students present more often helps students develop better communication skills. Many times, project assignments allow students to work with their hands and complete tasks. It's important for them to have developed some of these 21st century life skills. Projects are assigned as group activities. Being able to work with others is a necessary component of countless fields of work. PBL really comes in handy for those situations where students are just plain old bored of lectures. The best part of PBL is that it increases student engagement. Students will actually enjoy working on these projects and be much more pleasant.
How we assist is when you give assign a project for your student, how you assess it? Three sentences quickly. Before the project, just brainstorming, any notice, any project, the checklist. During the project, journal, collaboration, checklist, group conference. And the last one, after the project, feedback and reflection. This is activity about the PBL. You give the a map of the bus and all ground routes. You need to go from A to B, from here to San Jose. Find the best route with paying attention to the price, blah, blah, blah. The students, they research and they come out. That's an example. I think we cover this. For content-based, and the content-based here, the student learns the target language by using it to learn some other content. I give you an example here for next slide. For example, we have the Arabic Spring.
I have a question about that. PBL, is it possible to have a rubric for the PBL to assess the PBL project?
You see a group of students.
Rubric, yes.
We of course we need to develop a rubric to guide the students when they are work. What is the critical elements they need to pay attention while they are developing their final project? Yes, I will leave the assessment for Mr. Buja. I have 1 minute. I got from his time.
Okay,
I'll answer that question later.
Yeah. Students can learn about Arabic Spring by studying and reading the target language. The revolution in Egypt, the revolution, the trouble right now in Algeria. They can learn all of this through the content. Here is the preparation. We need to select a topic, select some benefit or beneficial sources to work on it. And during the, we are familiar with this, during the lesson, student, we assign tasks, groups, and they work together, InfoGap, and so on. Now I will leave the floor to Mr. Bojo. He will lead us for formative assessment. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. I have a very hard job, you know, to appear after so good presenters. Okay, so I will just make connections why formative assessment after introducing scenario-based, project-based, content-based, and a little bit short about task-based. Okay. So, as you can see, increased skills that cannot directly assess by traditional tests. And then let me answer a question. The rubrics. So can you go to the second video about strategies? So first, first, you will see the strategies of formative assessment, and then we will go back, you know, make a loop and make connections with and answer your question. Okay, go ahead.
If we take the three central processes in assessment of making sure that you're clear about where the learner is going, you're clear about where they are, and you want to establish how to get there, and you think about the role of the teacher, the role of the other peers in the classroom, and the learner themselves, you end up with five what we call key strategies. The first is the teacher's role in making sure that you know where the learner...
You mentioned five strategies. So we will make a short pause at each one. Okay, go ahead.
There is through questioning, classroom tasks, dialogue, so it's finding out where the learner is. Then giving feedback to the students, and not feedback that tells them that they're doing okay or they're not doing okay, it's feedback that moves the learner forward. Then you have the role of peers. First of all, helping each other understand the success criteria, so the teacher helps clarify what it is the lesson's about or the learning's about, and peers have a role in communicating that to each other as well. and then you have peers supporting each other, what we call activating students as teaching resources of one another. And you have students help.
So actually he incorporated two other steps. First one is clarifying, you will get handout with that and with some links to watch and learn more about what William Dillon is saying. So clarifying, sharing, understanding, learning, intentions, and criteria for success. So that's about all this. And the next one, engineering effective classroom activities, providing feedback, and then activating students to be each other's sources. So there's one more. Can you just
assessment or activating students as owners of their own learning. And that brings in all the stuff about metacognition, all that stuff about managing your own emotional reaction to school and to work. And so we get this complex of ultimately five processes. There's the questioning, finding out where students are in their learning, the feedback that moves learners on, making sure that everybody concerned is clear about the success criteria, student peer assessment and student self-assessment. Those, we think, are the five key processes or key strategies of assessment for learning. So much so that we would say that if you're doing assessment for learning, you're doing at least one of those. And if you're not doing one of those, then you're not doing assessment for learning.
Okay. And can you go back to references? References. I have to just point out one thing. The next one. References. It's not there, but you will see the references in handout. So don't we have enough copies of it? So formative assessment, as you saw already on the screen, formative assessment is ongoing process. But how to bring up a situation and how to create situation that you do formative assessment? So the first one of strategies is to clarify goals and set criteria. So, and rubrics. So, in project-based rubrics, if you go to Buck Institute of Education, I think, you can find everything about project-based learning, including well-designed, well-developed rubrics. And then we don't have to use old way those rubrics because they are created for different educational setting, for public schools. But it's a really good question. So first, we have to develop an instrument, develop tools. And also, please email us. We will send you formative assessment tools, handouts, or links that you can see, you know, what you can use to do formative assessment. So first, you have to be prepared to do project-based, to write scenarios for activities, between the big frame of content base, and then use those tools. So rubrics are tools to see what you have to do actually, what action you have to do to see how students are progressing. And then feedback, what my colleagues mentioned that. So if we don't provide feedback, we cannot call it a formative assessment. Could be still in the dynamic assessment that was presented in the first hour, or diagnostic assessment. But without giving, but when we give feedback, concrete feedback on concrete issues, so we are formatting actually students' learning. So that's why we, and if we don't have all those approaches to teach languages, and we cannot apply formative assessment. So. And the next thing I wanted to say about tools, yeah, about tools. So you will see, we will actually watch one more video to give kind of final cover what formative assessment is. But those tools, so tell me one tool for formative assessment or one way that you can use that, without any preparation, let's say preparation. But you are using that every hour. I will tell you.
Recall protocol.
Recall protocol is one, yeah. But your observation, that's a tool. So you have to observe students interact, not just interaction, not just person, students' actions. Because when we, in content-based, I will tell you one more thing. Yes, thank you very much. We have input, and based on input, students go to process. For those processes, we need scenarios for drilling, repeat special language features or grammar, and again scenarios for output, for their production, to see how much they are able to produce what they learned. And criteria is one of those things. If you don't have criteria, how could we write scenario and write steps, you know, and how could we expect, and what we, you know, expect actually, you know, to be as a product. So we have to know, is input really reasonable, or is above the level, or just I plus, and then what students' current level is. So all those things, you know, is under consideration in the whole thing. So can you play just short video? Yes, sir.
I have a question about the scenario-based learning, and I didn't hear real-life scenario-based learning. How can we create real-life scenario for our students? And our books and curriculum, there is about every lesson that at the end of the lesson, we have an activity, one student to do the role play like that American soldier, and the other is like the elder, and they give a scenario and the target language, and they play this role play like scenario-based learning. But how can we create the real-life scenario and for our students, because we never can bring real life situation in class.
Let me answer this question. First of all, before I answer this question, I just want to say, go back to the first point when we said, if we lecture, teach, we don't have time to do the formative assessment or motivate the students or. So how can we do all this if we are just teaching and we are not implementing scenario-based and project-based learning? But to answer your question, we cannot do the 100% real-life situation, because to do the real-life situation, we have to take the students from that building and put them in real life. So there is fake, real, and real. Real, we cannot do. Fake is when we follow the textbook with discrete passages, listening and reading. But what we are trying to do, what we mean by real life situation, is fake real. We, as much as we can, we put them in a situation that's similar to what's going on in the Middle East or the target culture, So we play roles, we play a scenario. And students sit there and solve a problem, but we cannot do 100% real life situation. Did I answer your question?
Yeah, we have a question about the IRC too. The instructor or the observer always insists to real life scenario in our IRC or in EB.
Yes, exactly.
But we
cannot create any real life scenario in Georgia.
Okay.
You are right. But don't wait to be, you know, just to have a feeling I'm right. We are not in the world where we are going. But in real life, a scenario comes. You are attached, you are deployed to certain area. You are attached to such and such unit. And there is disaster. There is unrest. There is whatever situation it could be, could appear, that involving our students as linguists in the real world. Give them the task, a nice scenario, and give them several steps to do task or project. First, if you don't give them concrete task, if you just, learn how to greet someone, that's an activity. So still you need scenario. a scenario for real life, you have real situation over there.
Exactly.
And how would you act in that situation? That's what we can do here.
If you don't ask the students to play the role of a doctor or a dentist, this is not real life. They're not going to be due to go there in the future.
Thank
but when you ask them to play the role of linguist, who is sent to the Middle East or to target culture, whatever target culture, I'm sorry, I always say Middle East because we teach other things. And the target culture, when they go there, they solve our problems that's in that target culture. This is real life because in the future, you will go there and you will perform this test. Thank you very much.
Thank you.